which July 7th?
July 7th, yeah.
2020. The greatest year in American history.
Greatest year. Anyways, hands down.
So, yeah. I don't know what to say. Now we're rolling, and I don't know where to begin. We were just talking normally.
So what are we talking about as far as prohibition goes? What were we talking about as far as prohibition?
I mean, prohibition ended with the 21st Amendment, so that means we can drink? I don't know.
Yes.
We're at a bar.
But could it also mean other illegal substances? I mean, could there be a prohibition upon marijuana, mushrooms, so on and so forth? Because right now there is being research and development with medicinal companies that are putting their money up against the research of psilocybin being a state of being instated as an antidepressant. Psilocybin being a thing of magic mushrooms, but apparently the research holds that, well, I mean, the research has been done that psilocybin actually works in that state and can really actually take you away from pharmaceuticals if you imbibe it and go through their certain processes.
Okay, so you're saying go away from big pharma and just start eating mushrooms?
Basically, yeah. But it's because like Timothy Leary did back in the day, yeah. with LSD. There's research and development being done, and so that there's trial and error. So they have to dissect it and basically put it into an environment where it can be used as a positive result for what they're trying to basically correct or cure. Yeah. Or so the research and development is still going on, but I mean, it could, like, natural medicines could basically take over pharmacology.
Okay. So you're saying that we currently have a prohibition on natural medicines?
Basically, yeah, man.
Okay. I mean, they're illegal, so yeah, sure. I mean,
so could there be a 420 amendment or some sort of other number that associates with psilocybin?
It was just coincidental that the 21st Amendment...
in year 21?
Yeah.
Yeah,
okay. I don't think that was the thing that they were planning.
I see.
I can use another beer.
I'll take one, too.
Okay.
21st Amendment. So you have to be 21 to drink beer. Coincidental? Or could that have been instated at a law?
I mean, I've never researched it to know whether or not it is or isn't coincidental, but I don't know. It's just a thing where you're 21, you can drink in America. I don't know.
So you're a tobacconist.
Yeah.
How do you feel about being 21 now, being the tobacconist age of...
So I've got two, like, contradictory viewpoints on that. Because of the nature of what I do, I manage a cigar bar, so I have a bar and tobacco. So for me, it's been 21 for years. That's just how it's been, and it's been kind of an annoying thing to me, where kids come in and they're 18, they're like, what do you mean I can't just buy a cigar? Well, we're a bar, you have to leave.
Yeah.
So that's been a common thing that I've had to deal with, where now it's, you just can't buy tobacco. Sorry, Scooter. you're just but not the customer base.
I remember when I was freshly 18 and bought my first pack of cigarettes. You know? Like we were coming, we were at the end of high school or at the beginning of college, and
yeah, you go out, you buy your first nudie mag, you buy your first pack of cigarettes.
I mean,
you
that's the way it was.
Lotto tickets.
Yeah, it was like nudie mag, lotto tickets and a pack of cigarettes, and you sat down and you just and you felt, I mean, like you were doing something.
Just because that's the thing that was right and that's the way that things were when we were growing up doesn't mean it's the way it should be. For me, like, going back to the whole tobacco now being 21, I'm okay with it because of my specific small little hole-in-the-wall business.
Yeah.
On the big picture, though, I don't like the fact that they did that because that's restricting tobacco sales and it's overall bad for the industry. But then again, isn't the tobacco industry bad for you?
Okay. So I have a thought. This thought is, so when I was in college and I learned about psychiatric development of the mind, we came across this subject which actually pertained to the frontal lobe and the development and the solidification of the mind growing to its full expansion.
Right.
The mind does not grow to its fullest expanded capacity until you reach the age of 21.
So then stimulants and other narcotics shouldn't be available until you're 21.
That makes perfect sense.
Okay. So we're in agreement then.
Yes, yes, yes. Cheers. Okay. Cheers.
Cheers.
Cheers. Yes, I completely agree with the 21 number. Even though that I smoked when I was 18, I still agree with the 21 number.
And how did that fuck you up as an adult?
Now I'm completely and utterly addicted to cigarettes, and I literally have a basic heroin addiction, but to a stimulant that basically does nothing for me. And I can't get rid of it because, one, back in like the 1980s and 1990s, it was okay for people to smoke in their houses. It was modern day China back then. I mean, people were all about cigarettes and they were smoking in front of their kids and like blowing smoke in their faces, and their walls were completely covered in tar and tobacco, and that's what I was raised on. And so ultimately I thought that was an okay thing. My judgment was made by the time I was 5 and could cognitively realize something was going on, that cigarettes were a sense of socialization and satisfaction, and that's something that I noticed when I was five years old. That's how I grew up. I grew up in a smoker's house.
Okay.
But that's okay. Because...
It's okay, but it's a thing that systemically has affected you your entire life.
Exactly, exactly. And so, like, at the age of 18, I was smoking inside of my parents' house. I mean, ultimately, cigarettes are a big thing to me. And it's probably been like that for a lot of people. I mean, you grow up in this lifestyle where smoking was basically the thing to do, and suddenly it's not. But then you have to think about these things. It's like, where did smoking come from? Why is there an Indian on a pack of American Spirits?
Well, tobacco was originally cultivated by the Native Americans, so that's why the cigar shop Indians were a thing for so long, because people associated tobacco with Native Americans. So if you put a wooden Indian in front of your store, it indicated that you sold tobacco, because during the colonial days and like the pioneers going across to America, they couldn't read, not all of them. So they saw an Indian, they knew, oh, I can get tobacco here.
Okay, but what did the Indians find in tobacco? I mean, like, yes, 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 there's some physical issues that come with smoking tobacco. But, like, what did they find in tobacco? Like, Indians were a people of, like, tobacco, peace pipes. They probably smoked marijuana. They tripped on peyote. They had seances and shamans. And they used to do these things where they would bring you into a hut and basically smoke the hut out with peyote, and you would go on this...
College kids would call it hotboxing.
Yeah, and so they would smoke it out with peyote, and basically, like, you'd be engulfed in this peyote tent, and there'd be a shaman in there navigating you through the nature of existence, and at the end of it, you'd be enlightened in a sense of, I just took this badass trip, and I found something within myself. I mean, it was one of those things. But then gets back to the whole, like, psychedelic prohibition, you know?
Okay.
Like, was Timothy Leary onto something, or was it, or maybe that was the start of pharmaceuticals. Maybe Timothy Leary was the start of pharmaceuticals and pushed medicine like that. Instead, maybe we should gravitate more towards Indian culture and try to do natural medicines that are provided by the earth, that are given to us for free.
I think there's been a lot of movement for people to recognize that things found in nature have benefits and can be good for you, but I also know that there are a lot of people that think if you drink apple cider vinegar with like lemongrass and like chili powder, it'll get rid of your toxins, and there's no medical science to prove that it does that.
No, it's not. It's not promoted by the FDA.
Well,
but...
no, like there's just no science. Like it's unfounded. Like it's a thing where medical science does exist. Science is science. You can't really argue with like things that have been empirically proven. I've met a number of people that have worked at Lilly, not to name names, that have been in like product development, and they've gone on about the process that they go through to develop new drugs and how they make their money. And it's this whole other ball of strings that's kind of its own inherent fucked up evil.
I mean,
especially
when
you get into advertising drugs in the U.S. But that's
yes,
a
that
side
is, that is,
tangent.
Yes.
My point is, they started to scientifically test things like magic mushrooms, the active ingredient that they then later cultivated into LSD, and then later found other ingredients and made ecstasy. And they were doing this scientifically to prove whether or not it worked, and they made a lot of headway where they were, I forget which prison it was, but they went there and they gave basically low-grade LSD to inmates. And they were able to work through some of their mental issues that put them in the place where they were at and why they were in jail.
Yeah.
And they had a higher rate of not committing crimes afterwards once they were released from prison than prisoners who just sat in jail.
Wow.
I have looked into this Mr. Leary fellow.
Timothy Leary is a...
But yeah, there's a thing where I think that there's a wiggle room for you to let science into this magical world of Native American, like, hallucinogenic drugs like peyote and other such things. But with the way the laws are currently situated, that's not going to happen here in the U.S.
Yeah. That makes sense. Right now, I think we're at either 20 or 30, somewhere around that, of states legalizing medicinal and recreational marijuana. And it is being pushed. It is being pushed through the country. That's almost close to half
But it's this weird gray area where the states have legalized it, but federally it's still illegal.
I think so. Here's my thing. Is the federal government guinea pigging the United States on medicinal marijuana?
Possibly.
Just saying. Like, are we their guinea pigs? I mean, is it going to be another Marlboro tax?
I mean,
how far does this country have to descend? How far does this...
Hasn't it already, though?
Yes, it has. How far does this country have to descend before we can get another legalized substance tax?
Every state that has legalized it to some degree has heavily taxed it. And yes, there are people making a lot of money.
A lot of money. We're talking millions, if not billions of dollars on this one herb that has been given to us by the earth.
Certain states being the guinea pigs, as it were, to try legalizing it, seeing how it affects their economy and ecosystem. Yeah, that is happening. I mean, we're in COVID America. Indiana's one of the first states in the Midwest to reopen, and surprisingly, we're doing better as far as numbers go than the rest of the bordering states who stayed shut down longer and are still shut down. So yeah, I think that's...
Are we about to get into COVID with this?
I don't either. But it's just an example. It's like that's the microcosm of having states control their own individual laws, is we have the ability to guinea pig certain states and to let them do things that other states disagree with.
Yeah.
And if you don't like it, go to a different state.
Exactly. And it gives you the option to just travel and be yourself. That's completely it.
Yeah, I'd say it's prohibition, sure. Why not?
Prohibition. It's what it is, man. I mean, that was just the first part of it. It's 2020 now. back in 1920, it was the prohibition of alcohol, and now we're in the mix-up of the prohibition of marijuana and other substances. So does history repeat itself, or can we change it? That's kind of another thing.
Before
it's like,
we started recording, I was saying how like this is all the end result of Nixon's war on drugs.
Yeah.
It's a thing that they started doing for whatever reason that made sense to them at the time, which, not trying to get too political, which I feel like we're just on the cusp on so many things.
Sorry, I've been talking to my father. He's a raging Republican. But in a good way.
He means well. He's not a bad guy. I like your dad.
He's a great person. Secret of NIMH. That was
first.
Yeah, you saw it, right? Secret
of
NIMH.
I think everyone grew up watching Secret of NIMH. Yeah.
Okay, so well, not everyone, but like the majority of our generation grew up watching The Secret of NIMH. Secret of NIMH was these rats that were test rats inside of this scientific facility. And they were testing them on I don't know what. But these rats broke free and started colonizing themselves into a different lifestyle and aspect.
Okay. So
what are your feelings on animals and animals being tested on?
Well, that getting back to the whole drug thing, like at a certain point it's faster to test things out on an animal. They have a faster metabolic rate, they reproduce more quickly. You will be able to see if a drug or whatever you were to give an animal were to affect its offspring, you'll know that within a year or two. Versus you give it to a human, you have 18 plus years before you will know that this has affected the later generation.
Yeah.
So, while I don't enjoy the notion of torturing animals for no apparent reason or a thing that could not be any use, it's a lot faster than torturing humans. And when we get into testing things on humans, we get into the whole, Germany 1930s. And I don't think we want to get into that.
No. I get you. A lesser species. I get it. I eat cow. I eat chicken. I eat duck. I eat...
Now, you eat chicken, but you have chickens.
I do have chickens. I do have chickens, and they're not slaughter chickens. They are egg-laying chickens. And so they produce eggs, and then I either give them away or I eat them. So I'm not one for the slaughter. I'm more for free range kind of aspect of things, but I think ultimately that's what The Secret of NIMH taught me. Animals aren't meant to be tested. I know it's a PETA approach, but like seriously, have you seen chicken farms? Yes, I eat at KFC, but like, have you seen chicken farms?
I have. Like, it's terrible. But at the same time, it's one of those things where you either need to recognize it's like, that's when you basically either have to start hunting your own food so the animal lives out in nature and has a better life before you off it.
Yeah.
Or you accept the fact that you're going to be a part of the machine where you like the taste of a steak. And you're going to accept the fact that their living conditions is not perfect.
Truthfully, this is my rant. I think all farmers should open up their gates. These big mass production farms should just open up their gates and let their chickens run wild.
Okay, but you think everything should be free range?
I think everything should be free range. I really do. Based on the structure of it's a lot better egg. I've tasted mass produced eggs. I've tasted free range eggs. I have my own eggs. I think my own eggs taste a lot better than the store-bought white eggs that have been basically cultivated on corn feed and grain, and they basically are stuck in a structure to where they're completely and utterly running around. with thousands and thousands of other birds, with no grass, no bugs, no nothing, those things that they actually love and admire. They're just basically trapped and used to just mass produce eggs. So I ultimately think all animals should be free range in the sense of a lifestyle of beautiful captivity, in a sense. Like, they should have more land than, like, farmers should take 3 or 4 acres if they're, like, it should be at least be a tenth of an acre for every 2 chickens.
So
I really think it should be.
How big is your yard area that you keep your chickens in?
A tenth of an acre for every 2 chickens.
Okay.
Like, and they're happy. They produce every day, and they're happy. They get fed worm. They get fed dried millworms. They get fed scratch grain. They get fed layer feed every day. And then I open up my gardens to the chickens. Like, I literally open up my gardens, and they can scratch and get into the bugs. They can eat the food. They can do whatever they want. Like, I spoil the living shit out of my chickens because I think that is the right way to do things. I really do. Chicken tastes good, but it can taste a whole lot better if
Have you ever eaten your own chickens?
No, I haven't, and I never will. But I've tasted other people's free-range chickens. Other people that have done the exact same thing that I did, and their chicken tastes a whole lot better than mass production chickens. Just saying. It's a little bit more gamier, but you have to like that game, because that gamey flavor is ultimately the nature of what that animal is supposed to taste like.
Okay.
Because you get into these cow farms, they inject them with like steroids and hormones to make them more robust and more meat driven, and they amp up their fluids and stuff. But you got to understand that those chemicals are actually being brought into your actual substance of being. You're actually ingesting those hormones and steroids. So it's just one of those things that you have to realize that, and if you're okay with it, you're okay with it. If you're not, you're not. But it's just a different way of thought that I think should permeate more free range, more love with it, you know?
So you want free range KFC?
Yeah, I would love free range KFC. I would so love it.
Okay.
That's all I ask. Like, when I was in art school, I did this project. It was a sculptural project on the KFC bird. And the KFC bird was literally so bad that it couldn't support its own weight, and basically shit and pissed and ate food all over itself until it basically was thrown to the slaughter. It was so steroided and hormoned up that it couldn't move, and then it was thrown to the slaughter. I don't think that's a way of life. I don't think that's a good way of life. I think that's a way of life that actually will put strain on yourself, because you're imbibing that bird's like DNA. You're imbibing that bird's like structure. Like, that's just how I feel. But anyway, on to another point.
Our original plan on coming here was to like rope someone else into the conversation.
We've been trying. Maybe we need to go to another establishment.
It can't hurt. I mean,
yeah, let's go somewhere else.
Okay.
Let's pay up and get out.
Sure. All right. Okay. Well, we're at location number 2.
We are.
Yeah. This road trip edition of A Gateway to Lesser Things. Very different feel, very different vibe from the first place. We should have probably started like commenting on like the energy that you feel from like, not like the like hippie sense of energy, but like, you know, feel the room. see how everyone's feeling, how they're reacting. This place is, there's more people in it.
Yeah.
But it's like, the vibe's just completely different than the last place we were in. The lighting's more bluish.
Yeah.
I don't know. The other place is more red. I don't know.
It's more calming in a sense.
Yeah. It's more low key, it's more chill. We had to go up to the window to order a beer. It's just weird because there's a full bar.
Well, if you post up at the bar, they serve you at the bar, but right. If you're sitting in the chairs, you kind of want to...
Barbecue. Ribs or brisket?
Ooh, that's tough. I'm a brisket man myself.
I'm going to appreciate brisket, but I don't know. Something about ribs. I just find that, like, when you can do that well. Because you can fuck it up. Make them chewy and hard to get off the bone and just, like, what did you do? Poor animal died for you to fuck that up?
Yeah. Yeah, I'm all for brisket. Like brisket tips are like mouth-watering gold. Like they're completely savory and delicious and chewy and everything a brisket should be.
So, but just the tips.
Well, that's the best part of the brisket. That's not talking about the actual brisket. Like brisket in an essence is just delicious. But the thing is, it's a big chunk of meat that you can cut up in whatever way you want. But don't get me wrong, I do enjoy me some ribs. But if I had to pick between the two, brisket.
Pulled pork waiting for you.
Depends on the day.
I feel like it's the hardest to fuck up.
It really is. I mean, you can put that stuff in a slow cooker and...
No, that's not the same.
It's not the same, but I mean...
That's not barbecue. That's crock pot. That's whatever. That's bullshit.
Yeah.
Like, it has its place in the world, but at the same time, though, if you had to choose between an actual smoked pulled pork or, like, someone put a chunk of meat in the crock pot for a while and walked away...
Yeah. And then just dumped a bunch of barbecue on it, yeah. Like, I used to work at a barbecue restaurant, and it was all in a smoker, and it would be on a rotisserie smoker for anywhere between 8 to 12 hours. They'd pull it out, they'd literally just pull it apart and throw it into a metal serving dish. And they grab it with tongs, toast the bun, and throw it onto the bun, or the pulled pork onto the bun, and then there was like several different barbecues that were associated with it, and so you could literally add whatever you wanted to it. Me, I like the Memphis style. I like the Memphis style of barbecue.
Okay.
And so Memphis style of barbecue is you add coleslaw to the pulled pork.
Okay.
And like you drizzle the barbecue on the pulled pork first, then you add the coleslaw. It is absolutely and utterly fantastic. I cannot eat pulled pork a different way.
So it's gotta have barbecue sauce and the
coleslaw. Yeah. It totally blew my mind the first time, and I just can't.
So not like a pickle?
Not a pickle.
You wouldn't put a pickle on there instead?
No. No pickle. Just
coleslaw.
You get a
coleslaw. Nice vinegary barbecue sauce and a pickle?
No. Now, as far as sauces go, there is a nice vinegar mustard sauce that I like at North End in what is it? Nora here in Indianapolis. Nora in Indianapolis has this great barbecue restaurant. They have this great mustard sauce. They use bone marrow butter on their French fries, and they literally saturate them in that along with some chives and bacon bits, and it is one of the most delicious things I've ever tasted. Bone marrow French fries are absolutely wonderful.
Okay.
But I'm saying again, that pulled pork didn't have any sauce on it. And you would add your sauce. Their mustard sauce is exquisite, but I would rather go with barbecue sauce. I really would.
Okay.
Barbecue sauce and coleslaw. Seriously.
I still have some pulled pork in my freezer from last time I made some, so I'm going to have to try that out.
Any type of barbecue sauce you want. You want hot barbecue sauce, mild barbecue sauce, sweet barbecue sauce. I mean, it's basically anything that you want, but it's just that coleslaw.
I feel like one should play better with the coleslaw, though.
It's a matter of preference, in all essence. It really is.
Year's halfway over.
July
1st was a Wednesday.
Was it?
Yeah.
Wow.
So the halfway point of the year was a Wednesday. It was the most Wednesdayest Wednesday to ever Wednesday.
Wow, that's pretty Wednesday.
Yeah.
So what are you going to do this year for the winter solstice? Have you thought that far ahead?
Same thing I do every year for winter solstice.
Which is?
No.
You don't celebrate the winter solstice?
No. What do you do for the winter solstice?
Well, I tried to throw a party last year and celebrate the winter solstice and the coming of winter. And it just, nobody showed up, nobody wanted anything to do with it, and so I was just like,
you sent out an invite a week before?
A week before, and it was...
It's not enough leave time.
I get it, it's winter, you need like a month in winter to like figure something out.
Well, not just in winter, like just in general, like people in planning, you want to have a bunch of people come over for a party? You're going to need more than a week's notice to be like, hey man, like just... Fuck your kids and your job. Come over.
Just come over and enjoy yourself.
It doesn't work.
No, not in a week's time. I guess we're adulting pretty hard these days.
That's the thing about time. You just get older.
Speaking of parties, what are you going to do for All Hallows Eve?
Yeah, probably nothing, given the state of
COVID
America and everything, yeah.
COVID nation, yeah. But the bars are open up. People are going back to work.
Yeah, but I mean, other states are shutting back down already. Like, Texas has closed their borders to other states. They're just like, hey, unless you have a reason to come into Texas, don't. People on vacation couldn't go to Canada.
Yeah.
Canada was like, no, get the fuck out. You guys are sick.
Yeah.
Shit.
It just comes up so often because
it's
a limitation upon the humanity.
It's so ingrained into the American psyche.
Yeah.
All anyone wants to talk about. I want to not.
I was talking about a party.
Yeah, but it's just one of those things where, like you said, it comes up.
Because of limitations, yeah. It's a limiter. It's a fun limiter.
So dolphins are evil.
How are dolphins evil?
The rapists of the sea.
The dolphins are the rapists of the sea?
Yeah, you didn't know that?
No, I had no idea.
Okay, so dolphins will, just have casual sex with other dolphins, male or female, doesn't matter. If there's a hole, they'll put their dick in it.
Wow.
Women have, it's just a common thing where, if a woman's on her period and she goes swimming with a dolphin, the dolphin will try to have sex with her.
Wow.
Yeah, it's...
It's ridiculous.
Yeah. Dolphins coming across other pods have been known to try to intentionally drown other dolphins.
So how does that work with 42?
Look, Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy?
Yeah.
I mean, they're intelligent, but they're assholes. I mean, when Earth was getting blown up, they flat just said so long and thanks for all the fish. And that was it. They were just like, we're out. Is that really off-brand for a dolphin? No.
No, it's no, really it's not. Yeah, no, that's it.
The Earth is literally going to get blown up for, galactic bypass. And they're just, out.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Pro wrestling.
Pro wrestling?
Yeah, did you ever watch it as a kid?
Oh, yeah. Undertaker, Hulk Hogan, The Rock, Stone Cold Steve Austin.
Yeah,
I watched that.
Have you ever gone back to revisit it?
Not at all. Not at all.
But the hardcore title's always on the line.
I know, all the time.
I just remember watching it in high school. Then I got a job and everything. I quit watching it because I was driving, and I went back and asked her
like probably about 2 years without watching it, and then I went to watch it again, and I saw like a guy wearing, walking around all sweaty and wearing a Speedo and a ring again, and I was just like, wow, that might have been the gayest thing I ever did this again, was to watch pro wrestling. Like, Jesus.
I mean, The Undertaker never wore a Speedo.
Triple H did.
Well,
The Rock did.
I mean, that's just kind of their thing. Like, if you look at like actual wrestling leotards, like it's very kind of constrictive. Like,
they stretch.
In USA, America, or like American wrestling and the Olympics, an actual wrestling leotard is very constrictive and very confined.
I'll say international wrestling.
Okay.
Versus American wrestling, which is what's on that TV right there.
Well, that's what I'm saying. That's what is based upon. If you look at these wrestlers, they're wearing leotards and
I don't know if it's based
clothing.
On that.
Well,
have you ever watched like a college level wrestling match on TV?
Yeah, they have helmets and they have
tight
leotards and they bind
zero
up.
Chairs.
I know, but like it's all about fashion and it really is. I mean, pro wrestling is like these big bulky guys with abs that are gonna take down the other big bulky guy with a mask and abs and a loincloth and. Like, I mean, that's. Look at.
Wait, a mask and a loincloth?
And a loincloth, exactly. Because he's Indian.
Okay.
So if you look back at, like, Grecian or Grecian.
Yeah.
In Greek Roman times, they didn't wear anything. They were completely naked wrestling and killing each other.
But what do you think? Okay, TV A, pro wrestling. TV B, UFC fight.
They're still in loincloths, man. They're still in the stretchy pants.
They're still in Speedos.
They're still in Speedos, yeah.
But now they're now pro wrestling's wearing clothes, and they're not like just wearing.
And he
onesies.
Has a belt. I get it. I get it.
I don't get it. I don't get it anymore.
It's the tightness. It's the tightness. It's constrictive, so it makes you feel your balls are in your gut, so you have to like punch somebody.
So it's the outfit that makes them angry?
I don't know. Maybe their balls can't breathe, so they're just upset.
Okay.
Or maybe it's just. Or maybe it's just when you're a pro wrestler, you don't want a lot of clothes because then they can grab the clothes and do something with them and throw you down to the mat. So you want to have as little clothes as possible on.
Okay.
So that's if you ever get into a fight, just strip down naked.
Okay, so you're saying that if we were getting a fight, you're. First reaction
is take off all my clothes. Yes.
So when you're pulling your shirt off and I hit you over the head with a chair.
well, there has, like that's why people just starts taking off their clothes as soon as they start getting into a fight. They pull off their shirt, they pull off their hat, they take off their earrings, they throw down their purse, they get rid of all these loose ends, and so. That's the reason. But yeah, if I were to ever get into a fight, I would take off all my clothes. Even if I'm getting the shit beat out of me, I would still try to take off my pants. The first thing I would do is drop my pants and just whip my dick out. It's the first thing I would do.
Let's
I don't
go.
Care.
It's time to fight. All right.
just start masturbating furiously and running at them with a fucking bottle.
You're
exactly.
Get your dick bruised.
It doesn't matter. It's what the Trojans did.
The Trojans?
Yeah, the Trojans. Okay, so the Trojan army back in like the I don't even know what century, but yes, they would masturbate furiously before going into battle, and they would have these hard-ons, and so that they would just get completely erect and just run into battle with these huge erections and kill people. That was their thing, and that's the reason why Trojan condoms are a thing.
Okay. I've never heard this.
Yeah, it's look it up.
I don't want to look it up. I'm going to take your.
Come on, get your freak on.
No, I'm good.
Yeah, Trojan Army used to literally masturbate fiercely before going into battle, and they would literally go and they would kill people with hard-ons. And it was in the Roman times too. The Romans did it. The Grecians did it. A bunch of people did it because they thought it was a sense of power and stimulation, and to the point to where it would give you an endorphin rush enough to go and fight into battle, because that's where your head was. It was just like, I need to consume something. I need to fucking go do something with this, and it would give you that endorphin high that happens when you masturbate. And they would literally just go and just start slaughtering people with boners.
But what happens when they try to procreate? Yeah, that was great. I need to kill something.
Possibly. I don't know. But.
So what, they just keep a free-range chicken off to the side of the bed where it's just like, and I'm done.
They kill a free-range
chicken. Is that why it's choking the chicken? No,
maybe. Maybe. Maybe that's why it's called choking the chicken. I don't know. That's a good assumption. So yeah, scantily clad males wrestling each other, that's normal. That's how they used to do it naked back in the Roman times. It's just that's how it is. That's how it was brought up with humanity in the appropriation of wrestling.
Okay.
Was to be as thin and as lean and as muscular as you can be.
So if you were a UFC fighter...
I am not going to be a UFC fighter.
If you were, would you rub one out before the match?
Well, yeah. Well, no. That's the thing. You would literally just get yourself about half mass, give yourself blue balls, and then just go at it.
So you're just angry. You're just doing it to
exactly.
make yourself angry. You're
exactly.
Not good.
Exactly. So you gave yourself blue balls right before the match, and then
so
you would
just be so...
So you're not allowed
to come until that guy's dead.
Exactly. Or, well, yeah, until he taps out.
Okay. Well, yeah, you're gonna bruise your dick this way.
Well, I'm not a UFC fighter. I'm not going into these battles.
I actually been meaning to talk to you. I've been taking courses online on how to be a hype man.
A hype man?
Yeah, you know, like you go out and I'm there with a megaphone. I got the champ here. I got the champ. He's undefeated.
I'm not gonna do this, man.
Come on.
I'm not gonna do this. No.
No. You,
it's ridiculous.
You just go in the locker room, halfway rub one out, maybe three quarters of the way, get on a Speedo, and you can leave your sweater vest on. That'll be your gimmick. When you get to the ring,
I'll be the Doug Funny of the.
Yeah. When you get to the ring, you take off your sweater vest, and I go.
Let's do this! Oh my god, that is ridiculous.
You can wear, he wears underwear over his pants. It's
exactly.
Perfect. He used to wear tidy whities and a sweater vest. Then you go out and fight somebody,
God.
And I get 10%.
Oh my god. What was his name?
Quail Man,
that's right. He was Quail Man.
Come on, be Quail Man.
I'm not going to be Quail Man.
Look, we've already figured out your method of attack, we've already figured out your costume, you got a hype man. You're three quarters of the way there.
So,
just like when you go to rub one out.
So if I were to ever go onto the WWF, I would be Quail Man.
WWE, but yeah.
WWE. WWF is expired, but yes.
Yeah, otherwise you're saving pandas. But I mean, we can do that too. We'll go to China. We'll go to save the pandas.
Halfway rub one out and save pandas.
Yeah. Or your little furry bastards.
We're saving you today.
Do not roll over onto your young. You gotta wrestle the panda away from its children so it doesn't roll over and kill it.
Yeah. So I was watching these sumo wrestler videos. And yeah. They're... pretty dominant over literally they grab each other by the underwear, and yes, again, they're wearing small amounts of clothing.
Do they rub one out beforehand?
I don't know that. I don't know anything about sumo wrestlers, but probably. And so they go into battle, and they literally pick each other up by the underwear
and do the
Honda thing, you know, mm-hmm. from Street Fighter. They do that, and they hit each other, and then they just lift each other up, and they do these, like these back bends that only, like skinny yoga girls could do. But it just blows my mind, because these guys are so limber and so with, like, physical performance that even though that they are fat, they can literally, like, pick up people and do back bends and do, like, somersaults and, like, do all these different things just to get that other person out of the ring. And that's the whole thing with sumo wrestlers, is they're trying to get that person out of a circle. They salt the circle, they do everybody has their intro, even sumo wrestlers have their intro. So maybe the WWE was like a combination of like wrestling and sumo wrestlers from China, you know? Like, maybe that's a reason for it. Because sumo wrestling has been around for such a long, long time, but everybody has their intro when entering the ring. That's why you see sumo wrestlers walk around the ring and salt the ring and have their intro.
I thought they were trying to purify the ring.
Exactly. So maybe the WWE intros that they have with music and stuff like that, they're trying to purify the ring with their essence.
So you need to go purify the WWE.
With a half-mast boner, yeah.
Yeah.
As Quail Man.
I'm down with it.
We're not going to do it.
Come on.
No.
Why not? Give me three good reasons why not.
No.
No is not a good reason.
No is a very good reason. That's one. Second reason, I am not physically fit enough.
Yet. We're going to bulk you up.
We're going to bulk me up. Okay.
All protein, just eggs.
Just eggs just all the
drink
time.
Drink eggs.
Just drink eggs.
You're going to need like four more chickens.
Oh my God. All I eat is eggs.
Just eggs, protein, you know.
But with being Quail Man, I can only have quail eggs.
You're going to need a lot of quails. You're going to need like 30 quails.
30 quails just giving me eggs, and all I do is eat quail eggs.
Just little tiny. They've got thick shells too, so it's going to be a bitch. But
no,
that'll build your little meaty claws.
Yes, I will have
you'll
meaty
have to crack
claws.
The thick quail eggs.
Yes, I will grow out my fingernails as talons. They will be 4 inches long, and I will come at people.
You will embody the quail.
I will embody the quail in their talons. Yes.
I think we got something here, man. this is another one of our better ideas.
Just takes a minute to get with it.
Yeah. I don't know. I one of our earlier ideas this week. I really feel like we should look into portable snow machines.
Yes, portable snow machines.
So what we want to do, because it's summer and it's hot as balls, we want to get a portable snow machine, load that bitch up with ice, and go like door to door. Hey, you want some snow when you're gone? You want to, you know, spruce it up, make it all like December-y?
90 degrees, and people have snow in their lawn. That is ridiculous, but it will work.
Hey, your neighbor's got a slip and slide. I'm just saying. You could go sledding.
Exactly. That's a killer seller point.
Yeah. Clean up some breeze. It'll be gone by tomorrow.
Exactly. It'll melt overnight. But you went sledding today. And, like, think of the amount of snow cones you can make with all this snow. We can pile it up in a certain area, build you a snow mountain, and you can just take ice cream scoops and just pack on the ice cream, the snow, and then just add your drizzle, and it would be a fun summer kind of thing to do with whatever you need. Just...
You got beer you need cold? No worries.
Exactly. Throw it in the snow.
We'll hit with some snow.
Exactly. I will take another Modelo. Okay, thank you.
Okay. So, yeah. I still maintain, though, my original idea. We need a karaoke bar that has a fully functional Chuck E. Cheese era animatronic backup band for the karaoke songs.
Yeah. Yeah, because
songs.
You could charge per song because it took time to program those robots.
Exactly, with each song.
Yeah, it's not like you just have a generic like mechanism. No, it's got to be to the beat. It's got to be like the keyboard goes off here. You've got the gorilla playing keyboard. It's got to tap out the right parts.
Exactly.
I would pay like $1.50, $2 a song.
Yeah, just to have an animatronic backup band.
Plus, that cuts through the crappy singers.
In a sense, yeah. But even the crappy singers have backup.
Right, but the crappy singers wouldn't want to pay as much. Because they're just going out to get drunk and sing with their friends. You're going to get the top-tier karaoke singers coming to this bar.
That's true. And especially if you get a knockoff Chuck E. Cheese, like, so many people would, like, go for that.
Mm-hmm. Like, you just get the Chuck E. Cheese band and you spray paint them different colors.
Like, Chuck E. Cheese would be, like, hot pink.
Oh, yeah. You get a Grimace costume, just slap it on one of the robots.
Exactly. And, like, a Hamburglar.
You can't do too many from McDonald's. Just the
but,
Grimace.
But the, and the
just the Grimace.
And the Hamburglar. Come on.
First of all,
nobody knows about the Hamburglar except for kids from the 90s.
And then no one knows about the Grimace anymore either. Okay. At least they tried to bring back the Hamburglar like 6 years ago.
What about Moon Man? The Moon Man played piano and he used to sit inside of McDonald's.
They got sued.
By who?
Okay, so he was imitating a singer. The like song that he played was like the same beat and everything, and the way he sang it was like just like a like popular singer from the 60s or 70s, and so his estate sued McDonald's because it wasn't different enough, and they had to stop using the Moon Man.
Whoa!
Oh, I'm good.
So the Moon Man, the reason the Moon Man is gone from McDonald's is because they got sued for copyright infringement.
Yeah,
because
they were ripping off the guy's style
and making money off of it because they would put
major money.
They were putting so much money into the Moon Man, and they
well, no, the Moon Man was just so popular that they were making money on it.
I think I know my next painting.
The Moon Man?
The Moon Man from McDonald's. You know, I see so many artists, and I think it started with Andy Warhol. They just keep ripping off of people.
Yeah.
So many. Like, it's like they can't come up with their own content.
Andy Warhol directly ripped people off as, like, people do today. Andy Warhol did it in a way where, like, he painted a Campbell's soup can to show the commercialism.
Yeah.
Because he started off as a graphic designer. So it was Andy Warhol's way of showing, like being one of the original people to, like, hey, here's a reflection on society. I'm going to paint Marilyn Monroe in a bunch of different, like, colors, even though it's the exact same shit.
Exactly. Like, what I do is I won't do screen prints of it. I'll I did this painting of a lion, and I was just like, all right, well, I need some interpretation of a lion. And so I went on Google. I Googled a lion, and I found like five or six different interpretations of a lion that I wanted to paint. And so I was literally just going through and getting out my gesture, not somebody else's, my gesture of a lion. But I find so many people are basically taking like Mickey Mouse and all these other characters and just basically redoing them in the exact likeness of what they were what it's meant to do, just to sell their art. And I don't know if that's a good thing or not, because I know Andy Warhol started it with the whole Campbell's soup bullshit, but like, why are so many people?
It was revolutionary for its time.
Okay.
By today's standard and everything that's come after it, sure, we can call it bullshit. But again, if you listen to Jimi Hendrix, technically his guitar skills aren't that astounding. It's just like when he had an off note, he just bend it till it fit.
I love Jimi Hendrix, and I love Andy Warhol.
Right.
But what he was doing was what it was for the time. It was copyright infringement and all these other legalities that get into it. It's just Andy Warhol was an artist. Maybe I love Andy Warhol. I love his work. I love his Marilyn Monroe. I love his soapboxes. I love every single thing that he's ever created. Don't get me wrong. But I think so many artists are pulling from that these days that they can just take and create something and sell that individual piece that somebody else came up with. I think we need to have new art. Like, go outside, paint a landscape, or do what I do and like look up animals or people or something, and like, well, not people, but like come up with your own original idea and be able to push through it instead of just copying somebody else's stuff. Do something new. I think we need a lot of new art, because art is still a thing. Well, how did I go off on this tangent?
It's fine.
You have a bunch of graphic designers that are just pulling from other graphic designers that are just pulling from illustrators that are basically reconditioning it in a certain facet and throwing it at companies, and then they're wondering why everything looks the same and why everything is that. You don't want that. You want something new. You want something fresh. You want something original.
But it's one of those things where when you find that pattern that works,
yeah,
everyone emulates it and uses it because it sold that last time, so the companies want to make money, so they want to reuse the same like layout of a poster even though the movies are completely different.
Exactly. That's why there's like 15 Aladdin. That's why Disney just kept doing the same movies over and over again.
Well, then they were lost after Walt Disney died.
Exactly. No, he's not dead. He's in a cryogenic freezing chamber under Walt Disney World.
Just his head.
No.
That's what I heard, was just his
head. He's literally, his entire body is in a cryogenic freezing chamber under Walt Disney.
What are we basing this off of?
Conspiracy theories.
Okay. The conspiracy theories I've heard say that it's just his head.
Why would it be just his head? They can't bring that back.
Well,
they
can't bring back a full body. What's the...
Says who?
Says science. Says the fact that when you freeze something, the water inside of the cells expand and damage the cells.
Okay, then you drain the water.
You can't mummify him and expect to bring him back.
Maybe he was into something else that we don't know of, and he found aliens, and now aliens...
The theory that I've heard about Walt is that they froze his head because they can then scan his brain pattern and put it into a new body when technology gets there.
So they're going to put Walt Disney's brain pattern into AI.
AI, or like once technology is there, you're able to clone him and 3D print his new brain.
If they have his head, they can clone him off of his cells, off of his DNA. They can literally clone Walt Disney.
Yeah, but
Disney.
That's just a genetically the same Walt Disney. It's not Walt Disney.
True. True. To be able to clone something is not the exact replica.
Yeah. It's not like... What was that Schwarzenegger movie? Oh, shit. It's one where, like, he gets cloned and,
was
like...
Was Danny DeVito in it?
No.
Oh.
Danny DeVito is in two Schwarzenegger films, Twins and Junior.
Okay.
Which I really feel like they should reboot those.
I do, too.
But do them as if they're, like... One's a sequel. So you start off with Twins.
Yeah.
And, like, you get freaking Peter Dinklage from Game of Thrones to Danny DeVito.
Yeah.
And then you get freaking Jason Momoa to be Arnold Schwarzenegger.
Oh, my God, yes.
And they're twin brothers.
Yes. Yes, that is so drastic. That is ridiculous. I love that.
Because that was the part of the comedy, and you make that the comedy. And then for the follow-up... Jason Momoa was a scientist.
That would be
awesome.
And then
you just have it be the direct sequel where Jason Momoa gets pregnant.
Exactly. And then, like, he's wearing, like, barely anything through the entire movie. Just because.
But we CG in
a baby
belly.
You don't need a CG in a baby belly. You just You just give him his...
A prosthetic?
No. Like, have you seen those Jason Momoa commercials, like, where he takes off his, like, body?
Yeah,
and,
that's
like,
CG.
Yeah. Yeah, but, like, but it'd be the same aspect.
Yeah, you just CG in a baby belly on Jason Momoa, and then he's...
And have it, like, actually kick and stuff?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
This is Jason Momoa's son.
Exactly.
Or daughter. Don't care. And
exactly.
Of course, super strong legs.
Super strong Jason Momoa legs.
Yeah.
I still don't understand how Schwarzenegger had that baby.
C-section.
Would it be C-section?
It would have to be. You're not going to push a baby out through your dick.
That's true. But, like, could you go through surgeries to push it out of your ass?
No, because it's a different pipeline.
You can inadvertently work that.
No, it's easier just to do a C-section.
I mean, how did he have a uterus? How did Arnold Schwarzenegger have
babies
a uterus?
Babies have actually been successfully carried and come to term and then C-sectioned, where, like, there was a slight opening in the uterus and the egg went out and attached on the outside. And the human body is a weird thing where it found the embryo and went, oh, we'll adapt and make a new uterus outside of this.
So literally, Arnold Schwarzenegger had a an adaptive uterus to carry that baby.
Yeah, it's a thing that medically has happened in the real
world. Like, when I was in biology in high school, they told me that...
It's super rare.
When I was in biology in high school, they told me that males actually have mammary glands, but it's stimulated by a hormone.
Yeah, there have been cases where a male's hormones get so out of whack, they start lactating.
Exactly. And they get so out of whack. And then, like, and it's basically because of a pregnancy, because you're associated with that woman for so long.
So then we have to get to the third film.
Okay.
Where Jason Momoa is lactating.
The lactationist.
Making superhuman breast milk.
Superhuman Jason Momoa breast milk. Exactly. But yeah, like... Males lactate when their female counterpart is pregnant. It's just a given. It happens. If you squeeze your nipples hard enough, you will see milk.
I do not believe that.
I swear to God. I swear to Christ.
I believe it happens in some cases because it has been documented, but I don't think every guy... Did you lactate when you had your daughter?
We're not going to get into that, Charles.
Did you?
We're not going to get there.
You're implying heavily that you lactated.
We're not going to get into that.
I'm going to take it as read that you lactated.
I'll talk to you about it off script, but yeah.
You don't have scripts.
Well, whatever. I will talk to you about it off script. But yes, males do lactate because of hormones that females give off during pregnancies. It's a proven fact.
Okay. I can't wait for this conversation off air. Let me just turn this off now. It's off.
I'm sorry.
Don't look at
I'm
those
sorry.
Lights.
No,
so
no, no, no.
Explain
it's
the
a,
time
it's,
that you're,
it's
your
a
nipples
gruesome,
bleed.
It's a gruesome story. I don't want to talk about it.
Okay.
So we're not going to get into that.
Wow.
Anyway, so how about cerveza?
Yeah, Spanish for beer. John has intro music.
And he has a ponytail. I want a ponytail.
Now quit shaving your head.
I can't. I love a shaved head.
Well, just stop shaving, like, the back part of your head. Get it.
You can just
skull.
Grow a rat tail?
Yeah, just... Like, map out, like, take a shot glass next time you shave your head, hold it to the back of your head so you don't shave that area, and just keep putting it in the same spot until you start to grow a nice long rat tail.
I used to have a rat tail back in, like, third grade. I had a rat tail. My hair was spiked like Bart Simpson, and then I had this long rat tail, and the thing was the kids that I was with kept pulling on it. And so my mom was like, you need to cut that off. And so I did one day. And so then ever since then, I've never had a rat tail. Otherwise, I probably would have. But like with rat tails,
you'd be more like a Jedi Padawan.
Exactly. I love you. You are so on my level right now.
Okay. So you're going to bring the rat tail back.
So I want to bring the rat tail back because it's the new wave Jedi Padawan.
Okay.
Instead of it being draped on the side, it is through the back.
For every month you start growing your rat tail, I will give you $5.
Okay.
So next time you shave your head, I got to see a little spot where the rat tail is going to be forming.
Okay.
And then I give you $5.
Okay.
And
I'm going to look so fucked up.
For the first couple of months. Then when you get to the
it's
point
just going
to
be like this thing just hanging.
Yeah.
Like, I'll eventually braid it and put beads in it, but, like, still.
I'll tell you what. I'll start having male pattern baldness and refuse to shave my head, effectively giving me a skullet.
What's a skullet?
It's where you're bald on the top and you have long hair. I'm on my way.
All right. Never shave your head, ever.
Fine. Until grow a rat tail.
All right. I'll grow a rat tail when your hair gets back to here.
No.
Yes.
No, because that's going to take like 10 years. And I want to see the rat tail before that. I might not
$5 a week?
$5 a month is what I said.
$5 a week and I'll go with that. So...
I don't know if I can do that. I can't do $5 a week.
$5 a week. It's less than a pack of cigarettes.
That's why I quit smoking.
$5 a week. $5 a week and I'll grow a rat tail. I don't know. Take a do like a GoFundMe or something.
I've done that before.
Josh's rat tail. $5. If you do a GoFundMe, it's $20 a week. And I'll grow a rat tail. If it's just you, then it's $5 a week.
All right. Just me and my Patreon, $5 a week.
$10 a week now. You can't add the Patreon and not want more money because there's more people associated with it.
You could start your own Instagram page for Josh and his rat tail. Once a week, you post an Instagram on it. You got two phones. You have one phone be the Josh's Rat Tail Instagram phone. And then you document the growth of your rat tail.
$5 a week?
$5 a week.
All right. I'll do it. I don't care. It's stupid, but I'll do it.
Okay.
It might look cool. Who knows?
I should probably get home because I have to work tomorrow. All right, man. Well, $5 a week.
$5 a week. Do the outro. All
right. It's been so long since we've done with these, I forget how the outro works.
This is a gateway to lesser things. I am Josh.
I am Charles.
And we will talk to you shortly.
Are you insulting the height of our listeners?
The development of give me a second. So the secret of NIM.
It's an audio recording device. We have a podcast.
Yeah, we do a podcast. It's called.
I don't care that you do a podcast. You do a podcast at the bar.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's hilarious.
It's so. No. It's a podcast. So
yeah.
So it's just audio.
Currently, we're talking about our plan to get a portable snow machine, and then go door to door during the summer and charge people up, have us put snow in their lawns so that they can cool off.
Exactly. You use it as a beer cooling agent. You can make snow cones. You can.
Your neighbor's got a slip and slide. You could just have a sled.
Exactly. It'd be the coolest thing to do in 90 degree weather.
Clean up is a breeze.
It just melts. It's the only places that are open at this point in time.
This thing is portable?
We can go anywhere. I mean, like, if we wanted to, we could go to the park, but the parks are closed, the restaurants are closed, and we usually do this at night because I have to put my chickens away. And that's at like after sunset, and that's right now it's 9 o'clock, so Well,
11:59.
Well, when you put chickens away, it's like 9:30. Sunset is at like 9 o'clock, 9:30. So I mean, you can't do anything. So we've set out to the bar to actually do our podcast.
I like it. I wasn't expecting that.
It's something a little different. Yeah.
I thought you were like people watching, talking about what you guys were looking at.
No, well,
we were watching the
bar and just. just like talk about it.
We were watching the WWE, and then we got onto the subject of how the about the clothing that the WWE actually wears, and how it's kind of scantily clad for men, and like where that originated from was like the Greco-Roman times, like with gladiators, they would do that naked. Exactly. And then we got on to some Trojan fighting and stuff like that, and how the Trojans would get half masked and just run at people and kill people, and like these are
exactly
and it's like, so what if you get into a bar fight? Just take off your fucking pants.
Honestly, you get kicked out.
Exactly. Thank you so much.